Hi, let's talk about the superficial features of the heart. In this video, we'll discuss the superficial features of the heart and how they relate to deeper structures. In terms of the heart, the basic structure is that there are four chambers. Superiorly, there are two atria that receive blood, and inferiorly, there are two ventricles which distribute blood. Between the atria and the ventricles are the atrioventricular valves. There is a tricuspid valve on the right side and a bicuspid or mitral valve on the left side. And then there are semilunar valves named for the vessels that they drain into coming out of the ventricles. So there is an aortic valve leading from the left ventricle into the ascending aorta. And not pictured here, but there is a pulmonary valve leading from the right ventricle into the pulmonary trunk. We can also see that separating the ventricles is an interventricular septum, and we cannot see, but I assure you it is there between the atria and interatrial septum. Now, there are several heart surfaces that are germane to understanding the complexity of the structure of the heart. And I've color-coded them for you in both a cadaveric photo as well as some medical illustrations here. And let's look at these. So the portion of the heart which would be immediately posterior to the sternum is the anterior surface, often referred to as the sternocostal surface. That anterior surface is going to be flanked on the right side by the right surface and on the left side by the left surface, oftentimes called the pulmonary surface because it is in contact with the left lung or the pleura surrounding the left lung. But make no mistake, the right surface is also in contact with the pleura surrounding the right lung. There's also a diaphragmatic surface, and that's difficult to see from a profile picture here. But if we look at the posterior view of the heart, which is here, we can see that that diaphragmatic surface is rather extensive. And that is the surface which would correspond to laying above the pericardium, which is fused to the diaphragm. Now, posteriorly, we have the base of the heart. The base of the heart is a rather trapezoidal-shaped region that is largely the left atrium. We can see the association of the pulmonary veins. They're delivering blood back from the lungs to the heart there. And so that is the base of the heart. There's also an apex of the heart, which we will discuss. And that apex of the heart is pointed inferiorly and left laterally. It's also probably worth mentioning that if we were to draw a midline, that roughly two-thirds of the mass of the heart will be found left of that midline, whereas one-third will be found to the right of that midline. There are also heart borders. And these borders I've color-coded for you. So this would be in association with the right side of the heart. We have the right border of the heart. And that right border of the heart is going to correspond deep to the right atrium. There's also an inferior border of the heart. The inferior border of the heart here is green, so that would correspond roughly to where the diaphragmatic surface is. That inferior border of the heart is largely going to be the right ventricle, but it will also include a portion of the left ventricle as well. And where that inferior border of the heart meets the left border of the heart. Here's the left border of the heart. That's the apex of the heart. That left border of the heart is largely going to be left ventricle, but there's also going to be part of the left atrium in association there as well. And then there's a superior border of the heart. That superior border of the heart is in association with both the right and the left atria. Now, these borders are useful, in particular when discussing radiography. So I have a couple of chest x-rays for you to see here. And we can see the outline of the pericardium that contains, you know, some of the great vessels and the heart within. And we can see that between these two radiographs, there's a very different amount of volume that is taken up by the pericardium for the radiograph on the right. So if I'm just to outline here, pericardium, we can see that the width of the pericardium here is probably much less than half of the total width of the thorax. And so this is a favorable, what they call a cardiothoracic ratio. Whereas on the right here, maybe this is an exacerbation, on the right here, we can see that the pericardium takes up more than 50% of the total space or distance between the rib cage. So this cardiothoracic ratio is much greater than 50%. And this is an example of a condition known as cardiomegaly, and that would be an enlargement of the heart. Now, size as a proxy for heart health has its utility, but it's not 100%. So for instance, a very finely tuned athlete might have a hypertrophied heart or a very, you know, strong, thick heart muscle because of training, whereas, you know, an individual with COPD might have cardiomegaly, hypertrophied heart, because their heart has to work extra hard to pump blood to the lungs to overcome any oxygen deficit that they have. So there are different conditions that can lead to a hypertrophied heart. So that's why I say approach, you know, size as a proxy for health with some modicum of delicateness. Now, the surface of the heart has various grooves within it, and we call these grooves sulci or sulci. Sulci are going to be important for the transmission of various coronary arteries and their branches, cardiac veins and their branches. So here, running between the right atrium and the right ventricle, we can see a part of the coronary sulcus there. We can see between the left atrium and the left ventricle another part of the coronary sulcus there. So this coronary sulcus is going to be in line with the fibrous skeleton of the heart. So the atrioventricular valves, the semilunar valves, so they're going to divide, you know, atria from ventricles according to those AV valves. So anything superior to the coronary sulcus will be atrium, anything inferior will be ventricle. We also have interventricular sulci. And so here is an example of the anterior interventricular sulcus. And we can see that both in the coronary sulcus and the anterior interventricular sulcus, we have coronary arteries and their branches, cardiac veins and their tributaries, etc. We can also see atrial appendages, and these are called the auricles of the atria. Auricle means ear, and so these represent space into which blood can flow during diastole as the heart relaxes. Now, as we look at the posterior aspect of the heart, we can see, you know, this is the coronary sinus within the coronary sulcus. We can also see there's a part of the coronary sulcus again. And then here, containing the posterior interventricular branch, as well as the middle cardiac vein, we have the posterior interventricular sulcus, also with a healthy amount of adipose tissue there. And these interventricular sulci, both posterior and, we can't see it, but I'll kind of ghost it in there, anterior, can be a proxy for the interventricular septum. And so the branches of the coronary arteries, so those anterior and posterior interventricular branches, are going to ride through those sulci and then send septal branches deep into the interventricular septum to supply that myocardium with blood. And that leads us to the assessment question of the video, which is the coronary sulcus serves as a conduit for heart vasculature and corresponds to which deeper structures? The corditendine, the fibrous skeleton of the heart, the interatrial septum, the interventricular septum, or the papillary muscles? The correct answer here is B, the fibrous skeleton of the heart, in particular to the atrioventricular valves, which comprise the bulk of the fibrous skeleton of the heart. Thank you very much for your time.